lie by Euripides, first performed in ancient Greece in 406 BCE, refers to the followers of the Greek god of wine and theater, Dionysus, famous for their ecstatic joy, frenzied madness, and amazing strength when worshiping the god. Dionysus, the play's main character, appears in Thebes in the guise of a charismatic young mortal from Asia. He tells the story of his history and why he has arrived at the palace gates. His mother, Semele, was the daughter of another main character, Cadmus. Cadmus has stepped down from the throne to hand the kingdom over to his grandson, Pentheus. After becoming pregnant with Zeus's child, Dionysus, she was killed. Hera, Zeus's wife, irate with Semele, tricked the young woman into asking Zeus to appear in his true form. As a lightning bolt, Zeus struck down Semele, but then secreted his son away to Asia. Now, Dionysus has returned to Thebes for revenge. His aunts, and Agave in particular, ruined his mother's reputation and his birthright. It's important to note that Dionysus and his followers carry one of the key symbols in the play, a thyrsus, a fennel rod. Fennel is a plant from the carrot family with yellow flowers and feather-like leaves, adorned with ivy, a symbol of Dionysus himself. The thyrsus is a transformational and also phallic symbol. The fennel rod acquires the power of the thyrsus when the Dionysian worshiper is crowned with leaves and raises it. The chorus urges Thebes to crown itself with ivy as a symbolic conversion to the religion. Striking the thyrsus on the ground produces milk, wine, and honey, representing nature's abundance and its usefulness to mankind. The chorus also dresses in another key symbol, fawn skin. Indeed, it's the standard dress code for the devotees of Dionysus. The fawn is playful and graceful, and also prey, and it shows up all throughout the play. In fact, all those in the play who don the fawn skin become like prey to Dionysus' violence and vengeance. The fawn skin suggests that humans, being mortals, are equal to natural animals. Back to the play. The newly appointed king, Agave's son, and Dionysus' cousin, Pentheus, another main character, has himself just returned to Thebes after being away. Pentheus has also refused to acknowledge Dionysus, who's already popular in Asia, and whose followers, called Maenads, have already entered the city. Pentheus does not know the god of wine, theater, and fertility has returned to his ancestral homeland to exact revenge, restore his mother's good name, and initiate Thebans into his religion. As part of his plan, Dionysus has already possessed all Theban women, including Semele's sisters, and driven them into a frenzy, sending them off to the forests of Mount Cithaeron to perform rites associated with the cult of Dionysus, including dancing, drinking wine, and even breastfeeding baby animals. Pentheus, who's recently learned of their disappearance, is horrified by news of their conduct. He wants to round them up and end the unhinged revelries. To Pentheus, Dionysus is chaotic and unbound by law. Law, the basis of social order, must be preserved. When Pentheus sees his mother and aunts have been completely overcome by wild ecstasy, he's afraid for what this new religion has done to them, but also what it may do to the people of Thebes. After relating his story at the palace doors, Dionysus, accompanied by the Bacchae, who also serve as the play's chorus, concludes with his plan for vengeance. He then leaves the chorus, the Maenads, who followed him from Asia, in Thebes to sing his praises while he returns to his new worshiping Bacchae, the women from Thebes, who are singing, dancing, and hunting on Mount Cithaeron, awaiting his return. Cadmus, now an old man, and his friend, the blind seer Tiresias, another central character, emerge from the palace bedecked in Dionysian regalia. They've become enthusiastic devotees of the god's rituals, but are soon scolded by Pentheus, who refuses to listen to their arguments for embracing the new religion. As Tiresias points out in his initial dialogue with Cadmus, no one in Thebes but the two old men and the women are embracing the new religion. As Tiresias sees it, only his and Cadmus' thinking is clear. Everyone else is wrong about the cult of Dionysus. Pentheus, worried more Theban women will succumb to this mysterious stranger and his dangerous ways, wants to have him arrested, and the same goes for the women following him. According to Pentheus, the Maenads cavorting is certainly not divine inspiration. Instead, their conduct is reflective of nothing more than an excuse to drunkenly disobey Theban law and social order. Dionysus allows himself to be captured by the soldiers. He's disguised himself as a stranger, a young wizard who leads the Bacchants. Pentheus mocks the god in disguise for his androgynous appearance, but it soon becomes clear Pentheus is more than a little intrigued by the stranger, and he tries to interrogate him on the cult's mysteries. When Dionysus refuses to reveal his secrets, however, Pentheus becomes angry and takes him away to be locked up. The Bacchae themselves will be enslaved. But Dionysus razes the palace with a tremendous earthquake emerging from the rubble to comfort his followers. He explains to them the god has wrought the destruction as punishment to the unbelievers. Pentheus is enraged. A herdsman enters to deliver astonishing news. An attempt to capture the maenads has been vanquished, and seemingly with nothing more than sticks. The ecstatic women were resting in the forest, drinking milk, honey, and wine, all miraculously springing from the ground. As soon as they realized they were being watched, the maenads turned to primal violence, chasing the herdsmen and descending upon the cattle, which they ripped to pieces with their bare hands. Pentheus decides the women must be stopped. Dionysus, noticing the king's curiosity, convinces Pentheus to first observe the rituals for himself. The temptation of seeing the forbidden is too much to resist, and Pentheus agrees. To remain undetected, he also consents to dressing up as a woman. Under Dionysus' spell, they depart for the forest. Here, Dionysus appears to Pentheus as a bull, another key symbol in the play. In Greek mythology, the bull is one of Dionysus's sacred animals. The cattle herder recounts how the maenads hunted and killed bulls in a ritual dismemberment. His followers believed him to be the incarnation of the sacrificed animal. Dionysus is often depicted as a bull in Greek art and religious images. The bull is only one aspect of Dionysus, perhaps the most aggressive, violent, and fearsome side of the god. A messenger enters to tell the tale of what ensues at Mount Cithaeron. Pentheus climbs a tree for a better view of the maenads. After bending the tall fir so Pentheus could climb onto it, Dionysus slowly releases it until it stands at its full height once again. It's an excellent view, but Pentheus is also trapped way up high. Dionysus alerts the maenads to the intruder in their midst. In a frenzy, the women, led by Agave, pull a terrified Pentheus down from the tree. As the young king begs his mother to recognize him, Agave tears off his arm. The others rip him apart until he's dead. In triumph, the maenads return to the now ruined palace, the Bacchae singing Dionysus' praises. Agave proudly carries her son's severed head, boasting about a successful hunt carried out with only their bare hands. The women believe they've killed a lion. Agave presents the head to her horrified father, Cadmus. He tries to make her see what she has done, but she is still under the god's spell. As he reminds her of her home, her family, and her former life, she begins to emerge from the spell, slowly realizing that what she holds in her hand is not a lion's head, but her son's. She cannot remember killing him and shrieks in grief when Cadmus tells her. He bemoans the punishment that has befallen his family, calling it excessive. Now Dionysus appears himself as a god. He declares that Agave and her sisters are to be exiled from Thebes, and Cadmus and his wife are to be turned into snakes. The Bacchae insist the god's punishment is just. Cadmus and Agave bid each other farewell and exit separately. The main themes of this tragic play have contributed immensely to its powerful legacy and longevity. Social order is one. After all, conforming to social norms is essential for the continuation of any civilization. And social order is contrasted with the wild nature of the Bacchae. Dionysus' followers sleep on blankets of pine needles, suckle wild animals, hunt, and perform their rites in the forest. Dionysus crumbles Pentheus' palace, symbolically crumbling feeble mortal authority and reflecting how the gods are more powerful than human constructs. Religious beliefs are another powerful theme. Conflicting religious beliefs are at the core of much strife in human history. The Bacchae is a powerful argument for the separation of church and state. However, Cadmus, Tiresias, and the play's chorus strongly urge Pentheus to believe as the Theban citizens believe, for the purpose of harmony and community. In this sense, Euripides is commenting on how Pentheus has let power separate him from the community. Distanced from the common citizens' religious beliefs by his own puffed-up sense of power, Pentheus clearly should have let the people believe what they wanted. He dies because he tried to interfere with what is sacred to the common people. Beliefs can be all-consuming for the believers, each believing they are the ones who see the truth, have wisdom, and possess a sound mind, while seeing the other as mad. Because each side argues so forcefully, fully convinced they know the true nature of reality, reality itself is called into question. Duality and disguise is a theme that shows up several times. Dionysus is a dual personality. When he's in his full form as a divinity, he is ferocious and powerful. When he's in his human guise, he's gentle and delicate. Each individual also has a dual nature, driven by primal impulses, but also as rational beings. People wear disguises in order to meet certain expectations. Dionysus exhibits duality in his feminine and masculine sides. As the stranger, he appears and acts feminine, and as himself the god, he appears as the masculine symbol of a bull, complete with horns. Indeed, he is something of a composite, just as he and Pentheus reflect the dualities of social order and religious ecstasy. Additionally, there are the dualities between the divine and the bestial, the real and the imagined, reason and madness. These dualities eventually blur identity. The Bacchae is not short on the gruesome theme of violence, the expression of passion unleashed, and the primal side of humanity running rampant, either because too much pressure has been building without any relief, or because reason has been rejected altogether. Greek tragedy is immersed in violence and death as central themes. Civilization itself may be an attempted bulwark against the violence permeating nature. Still, there are earthquakes, floods, volcanic eruptions, avalanches, and tsunamis. The ancient Greeks accounted for these natural occurrences in divine terms. Finally, women are a key theme. Regardless of how and why the Maenads ended up in the forest, the fact that original audiences, and perhaps even contemporary ones, are likely distressed to see these women abandon their expected domestic roles and live uncensored and unfettered says something significant about traditional views of women. Euripides prompts his audience to ask whether the women have rebelled against these constraints or if they're merely pawns in a god's grand plan. In so doing, he calls into question women's roles in society. The Bacchae has endured the test of time. Few details about the author of Euripides' life are documented, but this, the powerful, evocative, complex play, The Bacchae, remains part of his enduring legacy.